Good morning. If you rub a rubber balloon against your head, several things happen. Number one, the balloon sticks to your head.
Looking good, Mr. P.
Thank you, Bob. Number two, some of your hairs stand on end. And number three, the balloon... the balloon can now stick to the wall.
Flippin' physics.
The law of charges states that unlike charges attract and like charges repel. But that begs the question, what is charge? So I ask, what is charge?
It is the charge of something.
I think charge has to do with protons and electrons.
Charge is positive or negative.
Okay, you know what? Let's do some more demonstrations with the balloon to help us understand charge. Let's give the rubber balloon a little more charge. And then let's suspend it from the ceiling on a string. Now, I'm also going to take a rubber rod, a rod made of rubber, and I'm going to rub it against fur, and then bring this rubber rod close to the suspended balloon, and you can see that the balloon and the rod are pushed away from one another.
Oh, that's cool.
Nice. That is pretty cool. The balloon and rod repel one another.
I agree completely. Now, if instead I take a piece of glass and rub it against silk, we are going to get a different behavior. So now, the glass rod is rubbed against silk, and I bring it close to the balloon, and what happens is the glass rod and the balloon are pulled toward one another.
The rubber balloon and rubber rod repel one another, but the rubber balloon and glass rod are attracted to one another. That is a bit weird.
The reason this happens is because the glass rod has an excess positive charge, and the rubber rod and rubber balloon both have an excess negative charge.
Oh, that's right. The law of charges says unlike charges attract one another, which is why the negatively charged glass rod and positively charged rubber balloon are pulled toward one another.
The law of charges also says that like charges repel one another, so you can see that is true because the positively charged rubber rod and positively charged balloon are pushed away from one another.
But what does it mean to be positively charged or negatively charged?
Okay. A couple of things. First off, realize these terms positive and negative are attributed to Benjamin Franklin and are just names. He could have named them anything like up and down, top and bottom, charm and strange. But he chose positive and negative. Also, I did not say the objects were positively or negatively charged. What I said was the rubber objects have an excess negative charge, and the glass rod has an excess positive charge. What scientists know now is that the rubbing of the various objects against one another causes negatively charged electrons to move between materials. Negatively charged electrons move from the fur to the rubber rod and rubber balloon, and electrons move from the glass rod to the silk.
Right, that's what you mean by excess charge. The rubber balloon, for example, had approximately a net neutral charge beforehand because it had roughly an equal number of positively charged protons and negatively charged electrons. But when electrons moved from the fur to the rubber balloon then has more electrons than protons and therefore has a net negative charge or excess negative charge.
And before being rubbed on silk, the glass rod had pretty much an equal number of protons and electrons. But after the electrons move from the glass to the silk, the glass rod then has fewer electrons than protons, and therefore has a net positive charge, or excess positive charge.
But what are electrons and protons?
Right.
Sure, we can talk about that, but first, just to make sure, does everybody see how we showed the law of charges to be correct? If we label the net charge on the rubber objects as negative and the net charge on the glass rod as positive, you can see that charges of the same sign repel and charges with opposite signs attract. Correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. Electrons and protons are both very, very tiny particles which carry an electric charge with a magnitude of roughly 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs is called the elementary charge, and we use the symbol lowercase e to identify the elementary charge. The reason lowercase e, or 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs, is called the elementary charge is because it is the smallest charge which has been measured on an isolated particle.
But what is a coulomb?
Oh, I'm sorry. Capital C, the coulomb, is the SI unit for charge, just like the meter is an SI unit for distance and gram is an SI unit for mass. And I usually say coulomb, but it is also sometimes pronounced coulomb. Coulomb? Coulomb. Okay, let's get back to talking about protons and electrons. They both have the same magnitude charge, 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. However, the charge on an electron is negative, and the charge on a proton is positive. But realize their masses are very different. The mass of an electron is 9.11 times 10 to the negative 31 kilograms, and the mass of a proton is 1.67 times 10 to the negative 27 kilograms. That means the mass of a proton is almost 2,000 times greater than the mass of an electron. Also, an electron is an elementary particle. However, a proton is not an elementary particle because it is composed of quarks.
Quarks?
Yes, quarks. Protons are composed of up and down quarks. An up quark has a charge equal to positive 2/3 times the elementary charge, and a down quark has a charge equal to negative 1/3 times the elementary charge. A proton is composed of 2 up quarks and 1 down quark, which adds up to a total charge of the positive value of the elementary charge.
I thought you said E is called the elementary charge because it is the smallest charge which has been measured on a particle.
Actually, he said E is called the elementary charge because it is the smallest charge which has been measured on an isolated particle. I think the isolated word is important.
Right. To this date, quarks have never been found on their own, isolated outside of particles. So the smallest charge ever measured on an isolated particle is 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs.
Wait, what about neutrons? They do not have any charge.
Neutrons?
Protons and neutrons are in the nucleus of the atom with electrons in orbital shells.
Right.
A neutron must be composed of 1 up quark and 2 down quarks, and therefore have a net charge of 0. Right, Mr. P?
That is correct, Bo. Protons and neutrons are composed of quarks, so they are not elementary particles. However, quarks and electrons are elementary particles. And you know what? The law of charges is very important. So let's go back to the original examples with my hair and the balloon. The first example was where I rub the balloon against the fur, and then I rub it against my hair, and the balloon sticks to my hair. Bobby, please explain what is going on here.
Well, when you rub the rubber balloon against the fur and against your hair, electrons flow from your hair and from the fur to the balloon. That gives the balloon a net negative charge and your hair and the fur a net positive charge. The law of charges says that unlike charges attract, so the net negative charge of the balloon is attracted to the net positive charge of your hair. Therefore, there is an electric force that pulls the balloon towards your hair and your hair towards the balloon, and they stick to one another.
Correct, Bobby. And now I pull the balloon away from my hair, and the hair which was rubbed against the balloon, is now sticking up. Bo, please explain.
The balloon is now out of the picture, and all we're left with is your hair. Okay, each of your hairs has a net positive charge, therefore your hairs are repelled from one another, because light charges repel. So there is a repulsive force pushing the hairs away from one another, which makes your hair stick out like that.
Also correct, Bo. The last example, where the balloon sticks to the wall, is because the wall becomes polarized. We will talk about how that works in a future lesson.
Mr. P?
Yes, Bobby?
1.0 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs is a really small number.
That is correct, Bobby. It is a small number.
It's just really small.
Yes, it is really small. It is 0.18 zeros and then 160 coulombs.
Then how many excess protons does it take to get an excess charge of 1 coulomb on an object?
That is a great question, Bobby, although I will point out that 1 coulomb of charge is actually quite a bit of charge. If two objects, each with 1 coulomb of charge, are located 1 meter apart, The electric force on each of them would be roughly 9 times 10 to the 9th newtons, or roughly 9 billion newtons.
Wow, that is a lot of force.
And with just one coulomb of charge.
Yes, and we will learn how to calculate that electric force in our next lesson. Okay, back to Bobby's question of how many excess protons does it take to get a charge of 1 coulomb on an object? The net charge on an object, Q, equals the excess number of charge carriers on the object, N, times the elementary charge, E. That means N, the excess number of charge carriers, equals the net charge on the object divided by the elementary charge. For an object with a charge of positive 1 coulomb, that would be positive 1 coulomb divided by 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs per proton, or
6.25 times 10 to the 18th protons. Or 6.25 quintillion protons, or 6.25 million 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 protons.
That is a lot of protons.
Yeah.
I agree. It is a lot of protons. But that brings me to an important question. Can an object have a net negative charge of 2.00 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs?
Sure, that just means the number of excess electrons equals negative 2.00 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs divided by negative 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs per electron, or 1.25 electrons. So you just need an excess of 1.25 electrons on the object to get a net negative charge of 2.0 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs.
I do not think that makes sense.
Can you have a quarter of an electron?
No.
Right, so that charge is impossible to have because charge is quantized. Charge comes in discrete quantities in multiples of the elementary charge.
Oh, because charge is caused by having more or fewer charged particles, the charge on an object must be an integer multiple of the elementary charge. Got it.
So in the equation, net charge equals number of charge carriers times elementary charge, N, the number of charge carriers, has to be an integer.
Because you cannot cut protons and electrons into pieces.
Right, because charge is quantized.
And that is what I have for you today. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.